Dawn had already broken May 19th, 1980. It was 5 a.m. on the Columbia River. 2 hours before, the ship Korean Pigeon, with a draft of 24 feet, had passed the Longview Rainier area upriver without any difficulties. Now it was the turn of the Ho Mascot, a 660-foot-long Norwegian container hauler headed for Portland, with a draw of 29 feet at the stern. The skipper was Jan Erik Odegaard, but the ship was currently under the command of 16-year veteran Columbia River pilot John Satellich. Unknowingly, at the time, they were about to become the first victims of Mount St. Helens eruption on the Great River of the West.
About 5 miles down the mouth of the Cowlitz, we started to notice an unbelievable amount of debris in the river. The water was off-color, brownish, and the consistency of thick split pea soup.
As the ship passed Longview, it slowed so as not to disturb the vessels tied up at the port. The two captains spotted several tugs working feverishly to round up thousands of logs that had broken loose a short while earlier.
We talked to the tugs on the radio, but they gave no indication anything was wrong in the channel.
Off to starboard, out of the channel, the Japanese ship Tokai Maru yawed widely as it swung back and forth an estimated 400 feet on the anchor line. Its captain was puzzled. He didn't know why this was happening. Satellich requested a pilot be placed aboard to move the ship so it would not be a hazard, then stood off, timing each swing. When the Tokai Maru started to swing away from the channel, the pilot ordered the Hoog Mascot to proceed at 14 knots.
We noticed the Cowlitz pouring into the Columbia at 8 to 10 knots. Suddenly, the ship wasn't moving. I was in utter disbelief. We were in the middle of the channel and aground. I had passed the Cowlitz the day before with a larger ship drawing more water. The depth at that time was 51 to 55 feet.
Stuck in the channel and not knowing why, officers and seamen aboard the Norse ship watched helplessly as the Tokai Maru swung back to port and toward the Hoog Mascot. Fortunately, the swing reversed itself before the ships collided. For the next few hours, the Tokai Maru swung back and forth. Once river pilot Harold Smead boarded the Japanese vessel, an attempt was made to raise the anchor. It did not budge. The ship was then moved ahead at top speed to free the anchor, but to no avail. The Tokai Maru then tried backing off. Nothing happened. The anchor was stuck fast. The two river pilots ordered the anchor chain severed. The Japanese skipper objected, then let all 11 shots, that's 990 feet, of it out and dropped it in the muck. The Tokai Maru re-anchored out of the way about 10 a.m., below the Longview Bridge, now known as the Lewis and Clark Bridge. Satellich's next job was to free the Hoog Mascot.
The grounding was almost unnoticeable. The bottom was soft. We didn't know what happened. We had no idea that the volcano had sent 50 million cubic yards of debris into the Columbia to block the channel. I radioed the tugs to take fathomer readings around the ship. They found the water level to be as low as 14 feet clear across the channel. We didn't think the grounding had anything to do with the mountain.
The Norse skipper wanted to try to get the vessel off the bottom immediately, but Satellich advised against it, pointing out that soundings should be taken downriver for a distance to avoid another possible grounding. After about 2 hours, the Hoog Mascot attempted to back off. Finally, after much effort and the aid of some tugs, the ship floated free in the debris-filled river, but immediately a more serious problem arose.
Because of the thick consistency of the water, it was difficult to turn the ship around.
In a moment, the vessel was broadside in the river. It looked as if the ship first would be carried into a small boat moorage at Rainier, but then the current took hold and the Hoog Mascot was swept broadside toward the Longview Bridge piers at 10 knots.
My God, I thought we were going to have another Tampa Bay Bridge tragedy right here on the Columbia.
For several minutes, it looked as if the Hugh mascot would plow into the pier holding up the Longview span. Just a few weeks earlier, a Liberian freighter had plowed into the Tampa Bay Bridge and 35 people motoring across the span perished into the water. Now, visions of cars, trucks, and people plunging into the river spun through Sadlich's head as he feared a repeat of the Florida tragedy. He ordered another tug to help, and at the last minute, the vessel turned and cleared the span's pilings. For the next 23 miles downriver, the Hugh mascot took on ballast to lower the ship's propellers below the level of the debris floating in the river. A few hours later, the vessel was safely docked in Astoria. Less than 24 hours after Mount St. Helens erupted, commerce on Portland's vital water highway to the sea was completely blocked. A normally 40 to 50 foot deep by 600 foot wide channel in the area around the Cowlitz was as shallow as 14 feet clear across the river. A 130 foot deep hole 6 miles up the river from the Longview Bridge was filled with 90 feet of muck. Dredging on the Columbia began immediately, almost a year later. On April 9 of 1981, the dredge found something left behind that day, the anchor and chain of the Tokai Maru, a long and heavy reminder of the accident that almost happened the day after the mountain erupted. Thank you.